This video is brought to you by Magellan TV, a brand new documentary streaming membership service founded by filmmakers, bringing you premium content, diving deep into the subjects you want to learn more about. Magellan TV has the richest and most varied content on history available anywhere. Magellan TV has over 2,000 plus documentary movies, series, and exclusive playlists, many available in 4K. They have ancient, modern, current, early modern, war, biographical history, science, space, and even true crime, which can be watched anywhere on your television, laptop, or mobile device. We highly recommend their documentary, World of Weapons. Learn about the effects of gunpowder on saltpeter, how our arms and muscles work with projectile weapons, and the links between our biology and how we fight with weapons. All the shows are without interruptions from commercials, and we have a special offer where you can check it all out for free. Simple History viewers get a one-month free trial membership. Just go to try.magellantv.com/simplehistory or click the link in the description below. The German POWs forced to walk in a minefield after World War II. Denmark, 1945 to 1946. On the first days of May 1945, after 6 years of bloody fighting, peace finally came to Europe with the surrender of Nazi Germany. But with the end of World War II, new problems emerged, like what to do about the tens of millions of land and sea mines left over from the conflict. On May 4, 1945, the German forces that were in Denmark surrendered themselves to the Allies and started their arrangements to leave. Denmark had around 1.4 million active landmines in its territory that had been laid by the Germans along its western coastline during the years that they had occupied the country from 1940 to 1945. These mines were mainly on beaches and also around a few key facilities such as radar stations. Part of the act of surrender signed by the Germans stipulated that they should follow the Allies' orders on any matter without argument. The British military, who were in charge of the area after liberating Denmark right at the end of the war, ordered the creation of a group to clear the German landmines. It was already in operation by May 11, 1945. The Minekommando Danmark, as it was called, was formed from German prisoners of war, who were officially categorized as surrendered enemy personnel. The insistence on the Germans clearing the mines was because they knew how to handle those mines. They had information on where they were planted. The Danish authorities felt that this was in clear violation of the Geneva Convention, but didn't intervene or object at that time, probably because most of the landmines were on much-needed farmland and there was a growing food shortage in Europe. The alternative would have been that inexperienced Danish and British personnel would carry out the task. But there was also the thought that Germany was responsible for laying the mines, so it should be the Germans to clear them up. So between 750 and 2,000 German prisoners of war, with many teenagers among them, were forced to help clear away these mines. These soldiers were pioneer troops, so they had some knowledge in engineering. They were given some basic training in mine clearance, as well as having support by British Army sappers. These sappers were combat engineers who were experts in defusing mines. The reason this may well have broken the Geneva Convention, which governed on how civilians and soldiers should be humanely treated during wartime, was that the Allies were making the POWs carry out dangerous work against their will. The task was made very hazardous, as the Germans had not only laid so many mines, but they had used so many different types of mines throughout the war that made the task of clearing them so much more complicated. In fact, there had been 16 types of anti-tank mines and 10 types of anti-personnel mines commonly used by the Germans during the war. These included anti-tank teller mines, Holtz mines, and anti-personnel mines such as S mines, stock mines, and shoe mines. Many of these mines were booby-trapped or were hard to detect, as they were made mostly of wood and glass, with the only metal used in the detonators. To complicate the matter further, the mines laid early on in the war and their locations were meticulously recorded by German engineers, but later on, the mines were hastily laid by inexperienced, hurried units. They didn't take the time to precisely map where they had laid individual mines or at times where exactly entire minefields were. The German POWs used a number of methods to remove the mines, which would be seen as highly dangerous today. They would prod the ground with a pointed stick or bayonet at an angle to avoid triggering the mechanism on top. This meant that the deminer's head and hands were right up close to the mine. As well as this, no protective equipment was worn, and the demining was done in groups with no safe distance between them. Where there were metallic anti-tank type mines, British No. 3 mine detectors could be used, but for other types of mines, only a long prodder worked. Once the minefield was declared clear, the German deminers formed a line and marched through it. This was the way to prove that the area was now clear and there were no forgotten mines. Sometimes the local population was invited to watch as reassurance that their local area was clear of danger. In just a few months, 1,389,281 mines had been cleared. It's estimated that as many as 20% of German POWs clearing these mines in Denmark at the end of the war were either killed or badly wounded during this two-year-long operation. Though later, clearing these minefields was made that much easier, as it was discovered that some of the mines were painted with a semi-radioactive paint. This was a strategy used by the Germans, so they were the only ones who could find them. This meant they could easily and safely be located by a Geiger counter, but not with a metal detector. Using German prisoners at the end of the war to clear minefields wasn't uncommon. This happened in Norway too, where the German prisoners were not classed as POWs, but as disarmed forces who had surrendered unconditionally. This allowed them to be used for hazardous duties without being accused of breaking the Geneva Convention. At the time, there was little concern or outcry about this by politicians or the press, with the strong anger towards Germany during the war. But in recent times, there has been growing controversy over this chapter of Danish history, as some claim what happened to these German POWs amounted to a war crime. Most of the surviving German POWs involved were returned to their homeland 2 years later, though it wasn't until 2012 that the Danish coastline was officially declared free of mines left over from World War II.
Hey, Simple History fans, if you're looking for a better way to support the channel and help us create more epic content, consider becoming a member on our channel. Becoming a member means that for just $5 a month, you'll get these amazing perks. You'll be the first to see new episodes with early access. You can watch new episodes before anyone else with this perk. The Enlisted Badge, a custom icon that shows alongside your username in the comments section and in live chat. As a member, you'll become an influencer with member-only comments. You can communicate directly with us and help us pick the topics that we'll do next on Simple History. And remember, it's not mandatory to become a member. Our videos will continue to be uploaded as usual. Thank you for letting us feed your hunger for history.